Hello everybody, my name is Alice Straker and I am excited to be here with you at the Confident IT Professional. Today, we're here live at InfoTech Live. And so you can see it going on in the background, and I'm here with a couple amazing people. Really excited to share with, to introduce you to Eric. Some of you have met him before in our previous sessions, one of my colleagues, but we are super excited to chat with Dr. Timnit Gebru. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
It's excellent to speak with you this morning. Listening to your keynote, one of the things that you said was, AI is not a real thing. I'd love for you to just expand on that a little bit. What you mean by that?
Kind of killing my own profession here. So what I mean is that AI is under it. Honestly, I don't even know what AI is, to be honest. And I think anyone who's honest with themselves, even the people who coined the term, would tell you that they don't really know what it is. But over the years, specific specialties get called AI. So they become synonymous with AI. And then they like get downgraded, you know what I mean? So right now, when people say AI, it's usually generative AI that's synonymous with AI. So generative AI is a thing that takes as input text or a whole bunch of modalities, images or videos or whatever, and outputs kind of similar things, right? This is the task, and so that's called AI. And other times, chess playing, people call it AI, right? Like, or IBM Watson, when it was doing the Jeopardy thing. And then in the 80s, the thing that was synonymous with AI was expert systems. And now we don't hear anything about expert systems, or maybe people use it and it's become downgraded from AI. So that's what I mean. And so when people say, let's use AI, people need to ask the person who's this is being recommended to be to ask, what do you mean exactly, right? Because we don't know what you're talking about, yeah. Because it's not a clear term. It's a marketing term, like big data or some other thing, or we don't talk about big data anymore. It's become AI, right? So that's what I meant.
Interesting. Well, and that transitions us really well, because I've heard you emphasize too that, we often downplay the people behind these technologies, right? Behind these AI platforms. That we're seeing, and of course those that we're not seeing as well. And then it's interesting because in contrast, so many of us almost ascribe a certain level of agency to the AI platform itself. And I think we make a mistake when we do that. And I love that insight that you shared. So when we think about the people behind these technologies, what role would you say that they can have? How can they work to help these things be more, let's say, democratic or equitable? Because also we do talk a lot about that.
Yeah, so it's true that the only way that I think the hype can continue is if we downplay exactly how many resources it takes to produce these systems, right? Because if you know exactly how many things go into putting out like one image of a person with 12 fingers, you probably won't be that impressed. You're like, are you serious? After, this much water, this many people constantly like labeling your images and this many resources, this is what you can produce, right? But if you don't know any of those things, then you're super impressed. You're like, oh wow, you built a really powerful machine, right? And so to me, this is really a way to kind of centralize power, right? Because then, like you said, instead of ascribing agency to the institutions that are building these systems and holding them accountable and telling them to have different practices than they're doing right now, we're talking about the machine as if it's, its own kind of entity. And that's pretty dangerous. But that kind of helps the people who are building it continue to exploit the people behind these systems. In terms of making it more democratic, these workers, we call them data workers, are already organizing. So there's, in the US, there's an organization called Turcopticon, and this organization is actually, it started out as a collection of people who label data on Amazon Mechanical Turk, so I talked about it in my talk. So these people, they review, first they started out reviewing people like me, who was requested, and I got terrible reviews. Like, we had terrible reviews, so that was kind of their way of advocating for themselves. And now, like, one of the lead organizers actually works at my institute, so I told her, like, this is my past, I'm coming clean, you know, this is what I did. But, you know, so they're organizing for the rights of data workers all around the world. And they're kind of, so, you know, if you can't exploit them, you really, I really do believe, if you can't exploit data workers, you cannot have harmful AI systems on the market. The reason being that your market calculation wouldn't make sense. If you had, you know, it makes sense right now because if you could steal data, exploit everything or whatever, and put stuff out there, make money from it, you'll do it. But if you're not allowed, if you have to pay people 10 times more, 100 times more, you're like, this doesn't make sense, it's not gonna make me money,
yeah.
Right? And so I think this is kind of the first thing to do is make sure that these workers are not exploited. And then there's also the first African Content Moderators Union that was created last year by content moderators here. So they're organizing and making a lot of waves.
So one thing I'm definitely thinking about is a lot of the people who are listening are IT leaders. They're trying to figure out, you know, their partners are coming to them and saying, we want AI. And they know, if they've heard your talk, that it's just AI magic sprinkled all around, but they're trying to figure out, how do I implement this effectively and ethically? And I know that there are, you know, different thoughts out there around, you know, the things that people should be thinking about as they go to implement. So, you know, things like, well, what happens if someone misuses my product? You know, what happens if our culture changes, if there's some kind of shift in our society that's going to change how people are using it? What are your thoughts? What are some of the things that people should be thinking about as they go to, you know, implement some of this magicness?
Well, so I think IT professionals know what is real and what's not, right? And they know how careful they have to be when they're implementing things. And so I think they should stay with that. And the hard thing is people make you feel like you're behind or you're a Luddite or that's why, you know, you're just sort of kind of not with the times and that's why you're kind of skeptical. But my collaborator says resist to be impressed. Resist the urge to be impressed, you know, all the time. And I think this is kind of what they need to do. And so if they wanted to implement things, I think that the first thing is, again, what exactly are we implementing? Because AI is not a thing. So is it generative AI that we're talking about? Is it a classification system of some sort? Is it a predictive system that we think is gonna predict, you know, is gonna, because what we're doing is the current paradigm of AI is basically based on patterns, matching pattern, what is it called? Finding out patterns. Yeah, exactly. And so if it's a thing you can that can really benefit from figuring out these patterns, then sure. And, you know, but if it's not, so the first thing is like really getting down to the details of what's the task and why do we think that this task is going to be better than whatever we're doing. And then once we say, okay, once we decide that we really should work on this task, then, you know, a lot of the current paradigms, of course, are built on some certain kinds of data, lots of data. How was this data created? Where did it come from? Right? Who was exploited? What about copyright infringements? You know, right now, like, we know that you cannot copyright images that are generated through generative AI systems.
Right.
So does that put your organization at risk, you know? And also, you know, you don't want to steal data from artists either. So these are the questions I would ask. And so then really know your data. It's like making food without knowing your ingredients. You can't do that, you know? And
especially
also stealing ingredients.
World,
yeah,
with
exactly.
Allergies and all of that,
oh
you
my
gotta
God.
Be so aware.
Seriously,
so
exactly.
It's the same thing with as you go and implement AI, what's in it?
What's in
your AI?
And how did you test it?
Yeah.
We have been testing things, edge cases, reproducibility. If you can't reproduce, what I don't understand right now with people building stuff on top of ChatGPT is that you have no version control. You have no reproducibility. If you have a bug, how are you gonna try to even reproduce that bug, right? Because it can change, things can change all, you know, all the time. So I would take that into consideration. So how are you doing extensive testing? How are you, you know, for example, I kind of gave an example in my talk about, you know, a system, a face recognition system that had high error rates on lighter skin, like darker skin women, and no error rates on lighter skin men. So why did we find that out? Because when we did our testing, we specifically asked, how does this work by specific genders and races and kind of intersectional testing. So what does that look like for your scenario, right? And also, but even then, I kind of tried to make the point that even if it worked, the whole system shouldn't have existed in the first place, right? Like, we jumped the gun trying to make it, you know, reduce the error rates and things like that. So I would honestly say, these are standard engineering practices that you ask, right? It's, yeah. It's no different. You know, what is the standard operating,
the model, yeah.
Model,
yeah.
What is the environment?
Yeah.
Right? An engineer, you say temperature or this or that. What, you know, that's kind of what I would ask here. And how would I test? What is the task that I'm building for? And how would I test whether it's working?
I love the focus on the questions that you can ask prior to buying or building these, and starting with that really first, like, is this actually a need, right? Some of our members and clients are going to be in positions where, you know, whether it's a corporate mandate, whether they already bought into the hype
yeah.
before and they've already jumped right in, and now they're in a situation where they need to buy and they need to fulfill this need, whether
yeah.
it's real or not.
Yeah.
How would you say... what would you say are the implications of how we manage that now going forward, right?
Yeah.
What would be some of your key takeaways or the things that people should pay attention to if they're already in the thick of it now?
Yeah, if they're already in the thick of it, my condolences. but I'll say that, again, I would say evaluate. What is the task specifically? And they really need to understand the task and the model. What model, what specific model has been built on the task? So did someone just tell you they pre-trained something on whatever data and they're just asking you to adopt it? Are you making a custom model based on your data? So that's the first thing. And then the second thing is, how are you testing whether it's doing exactly the task you're talking about? Is it a well-scoped task to start with? You know, is it a task that you can test for? If you're claiming that your thing can do everything, then you don't even know where to start, what to test for, right? So how would you start testing for whether it's doing what it's supposed to do? And this is the standard operating procedures kind of thing I was talking about, right? And so what data are you going to evaluate it on? How are you going to get the data that you evaluated on? How did you curate this data? Did you just kind of scrape it from the internet? Or then you might get sued like IBM did, right? So these are the questions I would ask. And then what resources are really behind what each of these things that you're doing, right? What resources are going into them?
One insight on that I've heard you share that I really appreciate is that data is not all equal. It's not all diverse, right? Just because you have a larger data set doesn't mean you have a diverse data set. How can we do a better job of curating the data that we're using to prepare for these projects?
I think it first starts with the having a well-scoped task. Because if you set out to have an everything machine, you're going to try to have every data, you know. But if you set out to have a specific task that is well scoped, then you're going to try to figure out what data makes sense for that task. So it starts from the scoping. So for example, if I'm going to try to create an image recognition system that is scoped to recognizing disease in specific kinds of plants. As one kind of disease, does it have it or not, in specific kind of plants. I only need images relevant to that disease and that plant or whatever. But if I want to have an image recognition system that recognizes everything, then I'm going to try to just collect. I'm so data hungry, I'm going to try to collect everything. And exactly, and then I'm gonna be too overwhelmed with the amount of data to curate it, to understand what's in it, to properly document it, etc. So to me, it starts with the scoping of the task that you're creating.
So thanks. I wanted to wrap up with a little bit of a fangirl moment. So I first found out about you, it's a little off what we were talking about, but I first found out about you when one of my mentees mentioned, you know, what you had gone through, and her question was, you know, if this could happen to you with all of your credentials. And for those of you who don't know, Timnit was fired from Google. This was in the pandemic. a lot of uncertainty going on everywhere in the world, and now people are looking, especially younger professionals, and wondering, well, could this happen to me? So really excited to see and hear that you've been resilient. I guess in terms of last words, if you can just, kind of let our audience know, some thoughts in terms of how they can be resilient with all of the change that's going on in the world. AI is changing things. Despite the fact that, yes, it's magic for us, it's still changing the way we are.
Yeah. I will talk to the audience here, and I'll just say that, so some things that people told me are, go where you're celebrated, and we might not always have the choice to do that, but if you can see that there's a place where you're being celebrated, go there rather than trying to earn the respect of some other organization. So that's kind of what I did. I tried a whole bunch of different things, but then I said, if I'm not invited to the table, why don't I build a table kind of thing. And then with AI, fears, people should remember that it's people who have power. Machines are not rising up or what, we build machines. So we have collective power. We can decide what to build and what not to build. We can build things that help us. We can build things that don't help us. There's no higher being that's just kind of building AI versus that. We can vote to make sure that whoever is building things is held accountable. We can ask for better things, right? And so that's what I think. I think we have to remember that it's people who have power, and we control our future.
Our destiny. Thank you so much.
It was a
pleasure meeting you. Thank you, Eric, for being here. And thank you, everyone, for being with us today at the Confident IT Professional. Please reach out to us, connect with us on LinkedIn, connect with InfoTech. Be happy to chat with you further on this or many other topics. I'm Allison, and we're with Eric and Timnit. Have a great day, everyone, and thank you again for joining us here at Live.